I want to make just a couple of brief opening remarks. Some of them I will probably repeat because I know that there's still a long line and people are trying to get in. Today was a particularly fraught day here at Sinai Temple because they were filming a movie at the same time as all the normal activities. And so if you had trouble getting into the building, I do apologize, and I'm glad that you're here. You're here for a conversation. It will, I'm sure, have elements of the debate in that I anticipate some disagreement among the speakers, but we hope to do it without the antagonism that is so often attendant to such debates. And in order to do that, I have to both ask and warn you not to be antagonistic as an audience. That is, you feel free to disagree with what someone says, but don't feel free to boo or to call out antagonistic things. First of all, because it's inappropriate. Second, because it does not succeed ever. I have never seen anyone persuaded of anything because someone calls something out that's mean, ever in my life. So realize that you're also being counterproductive and you're making yourself look boorish, unpolite, and not able to conduct a civilized argument. And third, because if you're really difficult, we'll remove you. Just trying to tell it like it is. Having said that, and having started on such an ironic and peaceful note in this time of our general elections, I want to say that I think that this is an extremely important conversation, and the one thing that we are going to do in this conversation that may not accord with what all of you think, because I know that for maybe a third of you think that one of our participants shouldn't be here, and another third of you think the other shouldn't be here, and probably half of you think I shouldn't be here. I'm going to assume that everybody up here says what they say because they genuinely believe it, and they are not secretly racist or anti-Semitic or haters or idiots, but that they're spokesmen for their positions because not only do they believe what they say, but many others believe what they say. So you don't have to give people the same credit, but I want you to know that that's the basis on which this conversation is proceeding. And with that, I'm going to open with a very general question, which will give each of our participants a chance to sort of lay out their position. On my left, by the way, let me introduce them, is Mort Klein of the Zionist Organization of America. Feel free. And on my right is Jeremy Ben-Ami of J Street. So here is my first question, which is, apart from the love of and preservation of Israel, what is the time-lapse guiding principle? Now, what is the guiding principle under which you conduct your political activities? That is, when someone comes to your organization and says, what do you stand for? You have to say more than we care for the preservation of Israel. So what would you say is the principle that you offer to them? And who would like to start? Jeremy?
Happy to start, and let me just start by saying thank you very much to Rabbi Wolpe. Thank you to Sinai Temple. It is so vital for the health and the well-being of the Jewish community to have the ability to have these conversations. We are not going to agree on much, but I hope that one of the things that we can agree on is that we are a better people and we're a better community when we conduct these conversations. So I thank you for that opportunity. We have five core principles for J Street, and they've been our core principles since we were founded. I'll just articulate them really quickly. You can read them in more depth on our website. Number one is that we are a pro-Israel organization. It is the first core principles that what we do because we believe in the right of the Jewish people to a state. We believe that that state has a right to defend itself, and we are at heart a pro-Israel organization. Our second core principle is that in order for there to be a state of Israel that is Jewish and is democratic and is secure, we believe as a matter of principle there will need to be a second state in the traditional land of Israel, in the mandate that was Palestine, that will be a homeland for the Palestinian people. So we, as a core principle, believe in the two-state solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Our third core principle relates to what is the definition of being pro-Israel. It has been the traditional view for many decades that to be pro-Israel means to be uncritically supportive of whatever the state of Israel and the government of Israel does. We believe that to be pro-Israel doesn't mean you have to agree with every policy of the government of Israel. Our fourth principle relates back to this evening, which is that we believe the argument that then ensues over what that all means is actually very healthy for the Jewish community, and that we should have as broad a discussion as we possibly can, because when we constrain debate and we constrain discussion, we are actually hurting the well-being and the health of our community for the long run, particularly with younger people. And our final principle is that we believe that part of our core identity is a set of values and principles on which we were raised that form our identity as a Jewish people. Things like do not treat other people the way that you wouldn't want to be treated yourself, which is a core principle of Judaism. We apply these values and these principles to all issues all over the world as we do work to improve the world and make it a better place. We can't ask people to check those values at the door of Zionism. That's a core principle for us. We will take those principles and we'll apply them to the state of Israel and our relationship with Israel as well.
Martin?
First of all, as my wife has instructed me, I have to let everyone know that unfortunately, I mean, so it's okay, I have Tourette syndrome, Guillain-Barré Tourette syndrome. I've had it since age 5. It causes me to make sounds I can't control. I have some facial tics I can't control. It's largely genetically induced. My father also had Tourette, so I've always thanked him for giving me that. So I wanted you to know that. I also want everyone to know that my father, before I answer very briefly the question, my father was a Satmar Hasidic rabbi. As many of you may know, the Satmars were against the establishment of a state until the Messiah arrives.
And he hasn't come yet, in case, just to establish that.
Depends who you talk to.
Right.
If I may be so bold, say Jeremy's father was a leader in the Irgun, a ardent nationalist, I believe, right-wing group. So when you consider the opinions that Jeremy and I have, it's clear that both of us have strongly rebelled against our father's views.
So we have something in common.
Something
this is good.
In common. So what I'm doing is only because of my father did the opposite. I want peace with all my heart. I'm a child of Holocaust survivors. My parents were in Auschwitz. I was born in a displaced persons camp in Germany. I came here when I was 4. I lost most of my aunts, uncles, cousins, and grandparents to the horrible war. My father lost his first family. So I personally know the outcome of extreme and horrifying hatred toward Jewish people. I mean, basically what ZOA is all about is fighting for Israel's safety and security and fighting for a real peace and exposing the painful truth of the Arab-Islamic war against Israel. I won't even use the term Arab-Israel conflict. It's an Arab-Islamic war against Israel. I'll talk a little bit more about it later. And we consider ourselves rational centrists because truth is not a political position. Now, you may disagree that what I'm saying is true, but if it's true, it's not a political position. Winston Churchill was not a right winger. He was telling the truth about the aims of Germany at the time. And finally, I would simply like to say, to clear it up for those of you who read the articles we had in today's journal, Jeremy in the article claimed that ZOA supports a greater Israel. That's what he wrote. That is simply untrue. Whatever happens will happen. ZOA has never taken a position to annex more territory. The only position we've really taken with respect to that is that we believe Jews have a right to live in Judea and Samaria, no matter what the final outcome is. We have never publicly endorsed a greater Israel, so what Jeremy wrote was simply inaccurate.
First of all, you're welcome to applaud. Sure, applauding is fine. We're not the presidential debates. I just want to say, though, before I start asking questions, a couple of which I had already thought of, I've received probably about 20 questions. One of them was really to both of you, 19 to J Street. So if you have a question for Zio, please feel free.
It's all right. I have
none of them, by the way, none of them would I say are particularly embracing of J Street. But I just want you to know how I'm just keeping a running poll of what's going on in the swing states. So
this is deep red territory.
I want to start off by asking each of you questions that I think are challenges to your positions or positions that you've taken. So, Mort, let me start with you. If I and my father and my grandfather and my great-grandfather grew up in, let's say, Jerusalem or around there, and I'm a Palestinian who was born in Brooklyn, why is it that I can't go back and be a citizen automatically? And David Wolpe, whose parents came from Lithuania and Russia and Poland and has been three generations in the United States, gets to go back and become a citizen automatically. How is it that Israel can say Arabs should feel like patriotism and fidelity to a state that doesn't grant them the same citizenship as others and whose very national anthem says the dream of the Jews to reestablish their state? What do you want from me? How do you want me to feel about a place that says that to me?
Rabbi, you're not asking the questions that I gave to you to ask. It's not fair. Donna Brazile explained to me what I'm supposed to do. It worked for her. It's not working for me. Anyway, that was a delay because I don't know how to answer this question. No. Israel is not the United States of America. Israel is a holy Jewish state based on what God Almighty gave to the Jewish people in the Torah. America should have the same rules for everyone who once comes here or are citizens here. Israel is not the same. Israel is a holy Jewish state, a state of the Jewish people. That's what most of us want. That's what I want. And so that's why there's different rules.
Do you think that would be persuasive to an Arab Muslim whose grandparents
there are 46. There are 46 Islamic countries. There are 23 Arab countries. And he or she is welcome to apply for citizenship. They have to go through a process similar to what they go through in America. They can do that. But Israel is not the United States of America. It's quite simple. It's a Jewish state, and even Jeremy wants it to remain a Jewish state, as far as I understand.
Okay, right. Yeah, I mean, I understand, but I just want you to know, if you applaud all the time, we're going to have a lot less time. So
that's okay.
You can applaud. I don't want to step on your butt. Okay, Jeremy, out of the farrago of Jeremy questions, let me summarize it this way. The Arab political culture is undeveloped at best and extraordinarily hostile at worst. What makes you think that a group of Jews in America should tell Israelis to put a state on their border that is virtually guaranteed, given poll numbers and so on, to be extremely hostile to Israel? And would we ever do that? If, for example, Texas were inhabited by Palestinians, do you think we would say, okay, have a state of Texas, that's fine?
Well, you know, I actually find one of the premises of the question troubling, the notion that somehow the Arab culture isn't prepared to have a state, that somehow there's something in the Arab culture that is frightening to have them have a state. So I don't quite buy the question.
Well, no, I didn't say that. I said,
so repeat the question.
I said right now there is an underdeveloped political culture. I'm just looking around the Middle East, right? There aren't very many stable Arab democracies. In fact, I don't know of any. And there is tremendous hostility to Israel in the Arab world. I think those are two unarguable propositions.
Right. There's a lot of instability around the world. There's 196 countries. probably the vast majority of them are underdeveloped politically and otherwise, economically. There is no set international standard to, quote unquote, qualify that your people are good enough to have a state. I think that's it's a patronizing view. It sort of goes back almost to a colonial mindset that a indigenous people has to prove to the white man that they're good enough to have a state. So I'm not following the logic.
All right, there. Let me refine it this way. I would understand that you would say it would be patronizing, colonializing, if I was talking about a state that was like the British saying that about right, India. Let me finish.
The Germans set up a machinery.
No. Please let me finish the question, okay? I understand that because you just called me colonialist and maybe patronizing and racist. I just want to defend myself against that. Right, exactly. Okay, so I want to defend myself against that. I would understand that if you were talking about the British in India. But when you're saying the Israelis have to feel that way about someone on their border, and in order to qualify as somehow to meet the bar of what you consider appropriate attitudes, they have to give a state to a people that hate them, then I have a hard time saying that it's an issue of whether you're patronizing, and much more of an issue of whether it's safe.
Right. I don't know that we're talking about giving a state to a people who hate you. I mean, again, I don't buy the frame of the question. What the question for Jews who care deeply about the state of Israel is what is it that's necessary to be done to ensure that there is an Israel in 50 years, in 100 years, right, that is secure, that is democratic, and that is Jewish in its character and in its nature? That's the question. It is in the best interests of the Jewish people and of the state of Israel. It happens to also be in the best interests of the United States, which is why J Street is involved, for there to be two independent states in that land so that the national homeland of the Jewish people can be in one place and the national homeland of the Palestinian people can be in another place. This is a agreement between two people that hate each other. Let's have no illusion. This is not about a marriage between Israelis and Palestinians. This is about how do you stop 100 years of bloodshed and fighting and try to ensure that our children and our grandchildren aren't killing each other in 100 years. And the way that that's going to happen is if you separate the two people and create a border and have a state. But it's not about giving the people who hate you a state. It's about ensuring your own security and your own future.
I'll return to that in a moment, but yeah, please, by all means.
This is one of the things that I find troubling and perplexing about J Street, is they claim that the Mahmoud Abbas is a moderate peacemaker. In fact, Mahmoud Abbas has failed to fulfill any of the obligations under Oslo. I assume they signed the contract, the deal, they should be obligated to fulfill most, if not all of them. They have not outlawed any terrorist groups. In fact, they've actually merged with Hamas, a vicious terrorist group whose charter calls for the murder of every Jew in this room, every Jew throughout the world. Rarely arrested terrorists. When they do, they let them out very quickly. They continue to promote hatred and violence in every aspect of their culture, in their schools, in their media, in their speeches. They name schools and streets and sports teams and tournaments and children's camps after vicious Jew killers. They honor them. It's as if we have the Charlie Manson Cubs. I don't know how they're doing tonight. My God, no
nine
one's paying.
To three.
So are you telling me no
nine
one's
to three.
No one's paying attention here? Good.
Yeah. Someone's following the game during the
9-3. Marla has a little insert in her ear. She's getting there.
They pay pensions. How many of you know this? They pay monthly pensions to the families of Jew killers, of Arab Jew killers. The more Jews they've murdered, the higher the pension. That's Mahmoud Abbas. That's this culture. Their Fatah charter, not the PLO charter. Fatah is the ruling party of Mahmoud Abbas. I'll just read one line. They've not changed it. They've been pleaded with to change their charter. This struggle will not cease until the Zionist state is demolished and Palestine is completely liberated. They
so
put together,
stipulate.
I'm not finished. I'm not finished. I didn't interrupt you. You spoke for quite a while. Is it okay for me to finish? Would that be all
right?
Sir?
If you want to go on and on, we can stipulate that we're not making peace with the Swedes. I mean, I'm willing to stipulate that.
You know, Jeremy always says, as did Yitzhak Rabin, you don't make peace with your friends, you make peace with your enemies.
That's right.
To use an extreme example, do you make peace with the Germans? You only make peace with an enemy that no longer wants to be your enemy, that has changed their mind about it. You cannot make peace with someone who wants to continue being your enemy. This is the type of poster they make for every Arab who've murdered a Jew. This is one of those killers. And in Arabic, I'm told it says, a hero or martyr. There's Eged buses being blown up. It's a Jewish star being blown up, broken apart with blood through it. This is what they do. Mahmoud Abbas, the moderate peacemaker, this is the emblem he commissioned to commemorate the Fatah party. You see the shape of all of Israel with the keffiyeh over all of it, not just Judea and Samaria, East Jerusalem and Gaza. That would be one thing that we can argue about, but it's all of it with Yasser Arafat in the middle and a Kalashnikov rifle.
Okay,
the type of thing that a moderate who wants peace makes? Would we want such a state to be next to us instead of Canada, or to be next to us instead of Mexico? Would we be comfortable with such a state?
Go ahead. Okay.
You know, I am more than willing to stipulate that the Palestinian people are engaged in violence and terror and incitement, that there is a great deal of hatred against the Jewish people and the state of Israel. I think we can stipulate that. Because the issue isn't for us to spend the hour we have together talking about how awful the Palestinians are. The issue is, what do we, as Jews, as friends of Israel, do to ensure the long-term security of the state of Israel? The view that J Street takes, the view that I take, is there is no military solution to this conflict. There will not be a defeat. There are 12 million people living between the Jordan River and the Mediterranean Sea. Half of them are Jewish and half of them are not. There will not be a defeat of one party by the other without an unbelievable death toll and violence and bloodshed. In order to avoid that, we have to find another way to end this conflict. And the way to end this conflict is what I think we need to talk about, the way that we as friends of Israel can help to ensure security, the way that we can help to ensure that there isn't another generation of this fighting. That's what J Street is all about. And in our view, in the view of all the former heads of the Shin Bet, in the view of the former heads of the Mossad, in the view of former prime ministers of Israel, in the view of former heads of the IDF, in the view of the current leadership of the IDF, there must be a political resolution to this conflict that resolves the Palestinian legitimate need for a state through which they can get their national aspirations fulfilled.
Okay.
If we do not have that, we will continue to have the awful situation that Mort is outlining. No,
I think, wait. I want to ask you both a question. I'll come back. My question to you is, it is true, I saw the movie, it is true that all the heads of the Mossad, or at least six former heads of the Mossad,
that's all of them,
who clearly are, by any measure, not only pro-Israel, but aware of the security needs of Israel, spoke in terms of creating a two-state solution, and also spoke against the current policies of the government. So what do you know that they don't know?
I didn't see the movie.
Trust me on this, I saw it. That's what they said. One after another, almost in chorus and unison.
Look, I've read reviews that claim it was taken out of context. I know Carmo Gilone feels otherwise. He's an extreme left-wing guy. Most of the Mossad also agreed we should do Oslo, thinking this might work. When I spoke to Moshe Ya'alon a few months ago when I was in Israel, the former head of the Israel Defense Forces, he told me we should forget about the Palestinian state paradigm. it will not work, that they have the same goals as Hamas. That's the former head of the IDF. Even Boogie Herzog, the head of the Labor Party, only a few weeks ago publicly said, this is no time to discuss a state. There's too much hatred and violence by the Palestinian Arabs.
He said
he was against a Palestinian state now, saying we cannot have it. and when Prime Minister Merkel of Germany met with Bibi a few months ago, she publicly said, there's no time to make any significant progress. Plus, with the demographic issue, I don't know if you heard, Gaza was given away. Those Arabs live there in Gaza under the wonderful rule of Hamas. There's about 3.5 million Arabs in Judea and Samaria, 8 million people in Israel, so it's not 6 and 6. That's not accurate. And Israel's given away 40% of Judea and Samaria. That's where 99% of the Arabs live. So they have their own autonomy, they have their own parliament, their own schools, their own textbooks, their own media, their own newspapers, TV. They don't get to vote because it's a dictatorship, they won't allow elections. And the other 60% is largely uninhabited. The Jewish communities in Judea and Samaria comprise 2 to 5% of the rest of the territory. So there is no demographic issue. This is simply fear-mongering and simply untrue. If there really was an issue, I'd be afraid too, but it's simply not an issue. And I'll just say one more thing. And this is very important. The Palestinian Arabs were offered 95% of the rest of Palestine in 1937. You should understand, the original Palestine mandate, 78% was given to Jordan in 1922 for various reasons. Only 22% left of the Balfour Declaration. 95% of that 22% was offered to the Arabs in 37, the Peel Commission. They said no. Israel. Then we went to 1948. They split the 22% essentially in half. Not only did they say no, 6 Arab countries invaded. In 2000, they offered them a state, Ehud Barak, on over 90% of Judea and Samaria, parts of Jerusalem. Arafat launched a terror war which murdered almost 2,000 Jews and maimed 10,000 more. In 2008, Ehud Barak even offered more, 95% or more of Judea and Samaria, half of Jerusalem, with land to make up for the 3 to 5% they weren't getting. I was so horrified, I wrote op-eds attacking Olmert for this. When I asked Ehud Olmert what happened, he said, Abbas never got back to me. He never got back to me. In other words, let's understand this. What does it mean? And by the way, from 48 to 67, when they controlled all of Judea and Samaria, all of the Golan, eastern Jerusalem, they controlled it all. Were Arabs, Palestinian Arabs, attacking Jordan and attacking Egypt, saying we want our state in Gaza and Judea and Samaria? No. They won't accept the state if it means accepting Israel as a state.
Okay, let's stop there. And what about the history of Israel's diplomatic overtures that Mort recounts?
Well, the entire litany of his 5 minutes just now was just replete with errors and inaccuracies and falsehoods. But I don't want to debate the
I want to learn. Okay, I want to learn. Help me.
Right. I don't. First of all, you said, you know, there's 8 million people in Israel. Don't forget that 1.8 million of them are Arabs. So when you do your math, remember to subtract the 1.8 from the
I didn't 8. Say they weren't. I said there's 8 million people.
Right, but it's what I said is that there are 6 million Jews and 6 million non-Jews. You said there's 8 million Israelis, but you have to subtract the 1.8 million who are Arab. So the issue is that in the land that was mandatory Palestine, that is still under Israeli military control, is in fact 12 million people, half of whom are Jewish and half of whom are not. It is not a sustainable future for all of us who care about a long-term future for the state of Israel that is secure, that has recognized borders, that is accepted into the international community, that will get support from the rest of the world if there is another major war. We must have an end to a situation where 6 million Jews are ruling over 6 million non-Jews without providing them with any form of rights. So it's not going to be acceptable or sustainable for the future.
Can I summarize what I see to be the divide here? And each of you tell me what you think of this divide. It sounds to me like what you're saying is there's this large population that Israel in one way or another has to come to terms with and accommodate, or the end will be disaster, and that you're saying that large population cannot be accommodated as it currently stands because of their attitudes, because of the history that they've demonstrated. And so I would like you to address this divide. It sounds like you're not talking about the same question. Because what I started off with, I mean, when you said, for example, the Israelis hate the Palestinians, Palestinians hate the Israelis, I would ask you the question that I've asked many people, which is, if tomorrow, I mean, when you say the Israelis hate the Palestinians, there is clearly an animus there. No one's going to deny it. But if tomorrow the Palestinians had the firepower of the Israelis, and the Israelis had the firepower of the Palestinians, how many Jews would be left in Israel next week? That's a question. Is the hatred... No, but is the hatred equivalent? That is, when you say they hate us, we hate them, I don't think we're talking about equivalent hatreds. And for you, the question is Jeremy's question, which is, what's the long-term model here if they just hate us and we can't make an accommodation with them and they're not going away? So for each of you, how do you square that
when
circle?
I spoke to Ariel Sharon when he was prime minister, complaining bitterly privately to him about leaving Gaza and throwing 9,000 to 10,000 Jews out of their homes, he said it's unsustainable. We can't continue to be there. And he believes by doing this, this will really lead to finally an overall peace. Was it better the way we had it then, where a few Jews tragically were killed here and there, or now where Hamas took over and we have 19,000 rockets? In other words, it's not a lovely situation where you can get peace and a peaceful state, where you can get a Canadian-type state next to Israel. It's what's less dangerous. And what's less dangerous is to have autonomy for the Palestinian Authority until they decide to act differently toward Jews.
And what are you doing to help that happen? What are you doing to help that to happen? They're just going to decide on their own? Or does Israel have anything proactive they can do to help them do that? But that's an important question.
It is an important question. But let me just say, just remember, you know, this. Jeremy talks about this. You know, let's have a nice state and things will be lovely then. Really, Iran has a sovereign state. North Korea has a sovereign state. Syria and Libya have sovereign states. Are we happy they have powerful sovereign states? Or do we wish they only had autonomy with not as much power? By establishing a state under these circumstances, not if they would begin to change, you're going to get another Islamic terrorist state run by Hamas and Iran. They will take over. Much more dangerous than what you have now. And what Israel has been doing in 2000, 2001, 2008, they offered them a real state on almost everything. When they say no, what is Israel supposed to do? They won't accept it. In fact, Obama, President Obama, offered to push for a state, but they have to sign a clause saying no further claims. And Abbas said, I'm not signing that clause.
Okay, so let Jeremy go ahead.
Again, I'm just not going to respond to all the inaccuracies because there's just too many of them.
Name a couple, please. That's not fair to me. Don't insult me with inaccuracies by making a general statement. Tell me what was inaccurate.
What I'm going to focus on is is the choice.
Are you applauding Mort's inaccuracy? That's not nice. I'm just kidding.
I made plenty of mistakes, but not my last statement.
What I want to focus on is from the Israeli security establishment, what they would agree to, the Commanders for Israel Security, is an organization of 200 former major generals and above. They are making the argument that for Israel's security in the long run, this situation today is far worse than the creation of a Palestinian state that is demilitarized, which has security arrangements on its border that have been signed off on by the IDF, that are guaranteed by the United States and by NATO. This is what the Israeli Defense Forces and the former commanders of Israel Security are saying is better for Israel security. So for us to sit here as Americans in LA and to proclaim that we know that this situation is better than having a state of people who do not like us. I'm not going to argue. I'm not going to be the Palestinian defense lawyer tonight. There is no love lost by the Palestinian people for the state of Israel, but maintaining an occupation over them, which denies them the freedom of movement, that denies them the ability to sleep through the night, because Israeli Defense Forces do hundreds of home break-ins every single night, that doesn't allow them to get from their homes to their jobs without having to pass through 2 hours worth of checkpoints. If that is the kind of situation we're going to maintain, we're only feeding and fomenting further hatred and further violence. So I think we should be focused on the future and not on the past.
Can I respond?
Hold on one sec. I want to clarify before you respond. Has Israel, and this goes to the question of whether Mort's recounting is accurate or not, has Israel offered serious... made serious offers to the Palestinians that they have rejected?
There have been serious offers rejected throughout history. I mean, Mort is right. Started in 1937 with the Peel Commission, right? The Arabs rejected it. Started in 1947 with the UN mandate, and the Arabs rejected it, absolutely. But Mort is not right. When Olmert made his offer to Abbas, Olmert was about 3 weeks away from leaving office under indictment, and the types of things that Mahmoud Abbas would have to agree to give up in order to achieve peace, you can't make those commitments to a prime minister who is literally on the doorstep of leaving office.
What about Barak?
So Olmert himself, but I mean, let's just take the words of Olmert himself. When asked the question, is Mahmoud Abbas a partner for peace, Olmert says yes. So when Mort says he's not, the prime minister who did the negotiations said he is. Well, Ehud Barak, former prime minister, asked if Mahmoud Abbas is a partner for peace, says yes. Now, I know Mort says no, but the former prime minister says yes. Shimon Peres, when asked, is Mahmoud Abbas a partner for peace, said yes. Now, I know Mort says no, but the former president of Israel, the former prime minister himself, as well a prime minister, said yes. So I just ask you to take the opinions of people in Israel with security credentials, with the responsibility for running the state of Israel and caring about its future. Yes, we have failed to date. Peace efforts failed.
Is that the reason to stop
because of what's happened in the past, or do we have to keep going because it's the only way to secure Israel's future?
Okay. All right, first of all, this issue... By the way, Olmert also said that he never accepted any bribes. No, I mean, he's not the most honorable man, unfortunately. He was a friend of mine. He talks about demilitarized state. You know, at the Versailles Agreement with Germany, Germany agreed to have a demilitarized state, and then they were a sovereign country. They built the biggest and strongest army in Europe, and no one said a word, despite the fact they were supposed to be demilitarized. We saw what happened when we gave away all of Gaza. We got Hamas, we got 19,000 rockets. IDF, look, they have full autonomy with every aspect of their lives except security. Yes, IDF soldiers are in the Arab areas of Judea and Samaria because they keep forming terror cells to come into Israel to kill Jews. If they weren't forming terror cells, there'd be no IDF there. IDF doesn't want to be there. There wouldn't be no checkpoints. There's only checkpoints because Arabs want to come into Israel to kill Jews. We have checkpoints at airports. When I came here, I was at a checkpoint. We don't like the checkpoints. I waited an hour and a half in this checkpoint. Everybody wanted to come to LA, apparently. I don't know. We only have checkpoints because of Islamic terrorism. If it wasn't for that, there'd be no checkpoints at airports.
It is.
Benjamin Netanyahu has pleaded with Mahmoud Abbas for years, come sit down to the table and negotiate. Do you know for 7 years, this great promoter of peace, Mahmoud Abbas, has refused to sit down with Netanyahu except twice, even when Netanyahu, unprecedentedly, if that's a word, as Hillary Clinton said, did a full freeze on building in Judea and Samaria for 10 months. Until the very end of the 10 months, he wouldn't even sit down with him. He sat down twice at the end, and he won't sit down now. How are you supposed to, And why won't he sit down? Because he feels he will not sign a deal with Israel that says no further claims, that I accept Israel as a Jewish state. He won't do it. And he feels, because the way the world's been acting, mistakenly, unfortunately, he'll be able to get a state without making any promises, without changing the names of streets, schools, and sports teams after terrorists, without doing anything, and having a unilateral state, meaning he's ignoring and violating every aspect of Oslo, which means negotiated peace.
Is it in fact an accurate statement that the Palestinians have full autonomy except
for
security?
Well, I made a list. I decided to keep track of the inaccuracies
this
time.
Go ahead.
So, no, the Palestinians do not have full autonomy. In fact, they live under two different sets of law. The people who are Jewish and the people who are not Jewish living in the exact same land have two different sets of law. One is a military law and one is a civil law. This is not a good thing. This is not in keeping with our values as a people. You don't do unto other people as you wouldn't do to yourself. And it's not in our interest. It is not in to have the state of Israel be doing this to another people under its military occupation is not good for Israel standing in the world community. So no, they don't have full autonomy. There was not a full freeze, right? This is a common refrain of Morton and folks on my right, that there was a full freeze for 10 months. In fact, it was a partial chill of settlement activities. I visited the West Bank during that time. Construction was ongoing. Anything that had a permit prior to the day that it started could keep right on going. It only applied to residential units.
Why won't
units.
He negotiate? Why won't he negotiate?
So that's number two. It was not a full freeze. There is not full autonomy. For 7 years, yes, there have been negotiations. There was the George Mitchell process. There was the John Kerry process. The issue is that the state of Israel under Benjamin Netanyahu and the minority settler caucus that controls the government is not willing to agree on a state based on the 1967 lines with adjustments so that 80% of the settlers can stay in the state of Israel. That's the basis that the entire rest of the world accepts for the resolution of this conflict. And because that is not the basis that Israel is willing to accept, these negotiations are fruitless. It is why, another inaccuracy from a prior segment, Buji Herzog did not say that he doesn't believe in a two-state solution. Buji Herzog said, this isn't the moment once again pursue negotiations.
That's what I said.
Because, right, and the reason it's not the moment to pursue negotiations is because this Prime Minister of Israel isn't willing to put on the table the terms that are necessary to reach a two-state solution. So the proposal from Herzog, the proposal from these military folks, the commanders from Israel's security is, if you're not willing to negotiate, then at least stop building the settlements that are beyond the barrier. So I ask Mort, are you willing to agree with Buji Herzog, are you willing to agree with the commanders for Israel's security that it's in Israel's best interest to just stop building settlements at this point beyond the security barrier?
First of all, I will answer that. I still want to know, why won't Mahmoud Abbas sit down with Netanyahu and negotiate? Look, they've already been offered a state in 2000, 2001, 2008.
Okay, wait a second. That's rehearsing what we've already said. The question is, are you willing to stop building in...
Another major myth.
The question is, not a myth.
I'm in the middle of speaking. Thank you.
But answer the question.
I will try. If you stop speaking, I will try and do so. The Jewish communities in Judea and Samaria comprise 2 to 5% of all of Judea and Samaria. That's it. Since 1993, when Oslo began, there hasn't been a single authorized new community in Judea and Samaria since 93. There have been some unauthorized ones with a few houses here and there. Not a single new community. The building that has occurred since 93 has been within the boundaries of the existing communities, within Efrat, within Ariel, within Maal Damim. That's why there's been no expansion. There's still over 50% of the territory is still essentially uninhabited. So when you read about, you know, settlement building like this, you've read about a new building in Shiloh. It's in Shiloh, within the boundaries there. It doesn't take up any more land that's already available for a possible state. So that's really a very important myth. And Abbas's UN speech...
Still waiting for the answer to the question. Are you willing to say that it's in Israel's interest to stop building settlements beyond the wall?
No. I support what Arafat and Rabin signed. They both signed agreed that Israel is allowed to keep building until there's a final resolution. That's what the Palestinian Authority agreed to in the Oslo agreements.
How many, by the way, how many people now live in those communities over this, let's say, what's the increase in population in the past 10, 20 years?
It's not relevant because the increase in population, is within the existing,
let me ask you a question.
There's no more land taken.
You don't know my question. I know that, you say there's no more additional land. When communities expand, it's more land. So it's clearly additional land. It may be within boundaries. My question to you is,
The Beverly Hills Hotel is building a new addition. Beverly Hills is
so they're
not
only
being
building
expanded.
Up. So they're only building up.
And not expanding.
All the new settlements are just like the towers.
Of Beverly Hills. Beverly Hills is not getting any bigger.
If you were a Palestinian looking at these at this construction, would you say to yourself, it's obvious that they're still interested in creating a two-state solution? Or might you think to yourself, they're trying to create that famous Israeli phrase, facts on the ground?
Rabbi.
Can't you? I want you to empathize with someone else.
Because
you won't do that.
Isn't Mahmoud Abbas saying to Netanyahu,
you're answering my question. If you were a Palestinian living in that area, might you think that the Israelis are trying to create facts on the ground that will make a state impossible?
The Palestinians, many thousands of them, work for the communities in Judea and Samaria, making four times what they make elsewhere. They're very happy to have those small communities there.
So the Palestinians support the settlements?
The Palestinian Arabs are very happy to be working there, but that's not
okay.
the issue. The
All right,
issue
now let me ask you a question.
Why doesn't Abbas sit down and negotiate
let me ask you a
final
a question.
Resolution?
Is it true that J Street is trying to get the Treasury Department to take away tax-exempt status from American charities that support...
illegal settlements.
That support things, settlements in Israel.
Yes.
So in other words, you're trying to prevent various American Jewish charities, for example, from having a tax-exempt status because you have a political disagreement with them.
No, we're saying that the donations, the organizations can retain their tax-exempt status, but the donations, when they get a tax-deductible charitable donation status, are costing us money. We, as taxpayers, are subsidizing by giving people a tax break for their donations. The organizations, Friends of Ofra and the Hebron Fund, can continue to be tax-exempt organizations, but the donations to those charities should not receive a deduction from your income tax. That's me subsidizing people settling in Hebron and deepening this conflict against Israeli and American and international law. Let me list out the inaccuracies. I just am doing my own factcheck.org here. Okay, well, I mean, I'll start with Palestinians are very happy. No, Palestinians, I can guarantee you, are not very happy about this overall situation. There has been no more land taking. Wrong. The entirety of this Supreme Court case that's going on right now in Israel is in front of the Supreme Court because settlers are claiming and confiscating privately owned Palestinian land on a systematic basis and building settlements on it. And it's being brought before the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court of Israel said that's what they're doing. They have to stop and get off that land, and now they won't leave. So, yes, there's land taking. It is illegal. Under Israeli law, not just under international law, not just under American law, it's according to the Israeli Supreme Court what the settlers are doing is illegal. There has been no expansion of the settlement since 1993. There were 125,000 settlers living beyond Jerusalem on the West Bank when the Oslo process started. Today there are over 350,000. I guarantee you that the tripling of the settler population in those 25 years did not happen in the exact same dimensions of the land that was occupied in 1993. And the way that they do it is if you visit, and I urge all of you to visit and see this for yourself, a settlement is built on one hilltop. The next hilltop starts having some building put on it, and the settlers say, oh, that's not a new settlement, that's a new neighborhood of the existing settlement. And so hilltop after hilltop after hilltop are suddenly part of the first hilltop's settlement. And Mort can sit here and say there hasn't been any new settlement building, they haven't expanded the boundaries, but that's because they're simply renaming every hilltop to say, well, it's not just Ephrat, it's Ephrat A, Ephrat B, Ephrat C, Ephrat D, and you suddenly have a sausage of Ephrat that extends over about a you know, 3 mile period that is taking the land. Much of it, in many cases, is in fact Palestinian private land and is illegal, and that's what we say the United States government shouldn't be providing a tax deduction for donations from American citizens to support illegal activity.
It's interesting. You're trying to stop funds for Jews in Judea and Samaria, yet you're saying nothing about the Palestinian Authority getting $700 million a year from the United States. Would you agree that that should be at least cut by the amount of money they spend on giving pensions to the families of Jew killers?
So again, inaccuracy. So, you know, I love now that we're doing this, the fact check thing. So they don't get 700, the Palestinian Authority actually gets how much money? Just a wild guess, how many dollars are sent by the US government to the Palestinian Authority? Zero. Zero. $0 go from us to the Palestinian Authority. There are three types of money that the United States government provides to the West Bank for Palestinians. The first is to support the training and the equipping and the facilitation of the security forces of the Palestinian Authority that work hand in hand with the IDF. The IDF credits the American trained Palestinian security forces with one of the main reasons why the West Bank, by and large, is a lot more secure than it was 10 years ago, because of the American assistance that it provides in kind through training of the Palestinian security forces. So I don't think we want to cut that. That's something that the IDF would be very
not
upset
true.
If we cut. What's not true?
Almost every general I spoke to, when I asked why has there been a reduction in terrorism and Islamic terrorism against Jews, they say it's because before 2006, before the terror war began in 2000, we didn't have the IDF going into Arab areas. Now we do. They're rooting out terror cells, stopping terrorism before it begins. That and a small basis for it is the fence. The fence that was built. It is not because of the Palestinian security forces who have not done an effective job.
So that's one type of aid, and we can disagree, but I just urge you to Google this question tonight when you go home and see what the IDF has said, and in fact, at times the government
Moshe
of Israel
told me
has intervened with the Congress, which has been egged on by the American Jewish community to try to do what Mort wants to do, which is to cut that aid, and actually the government of Israel intervenes with Congress and says, please don't do that because this is so important to our own security.
The other two being?
So the other two are the U.S. government pays the Israeli electric company, they pay the bill of the Palestinian Authority. The money goes directly to the electric company, so actually it goes directly from the United States to Israel to pay off some of the Palestinian Authority's debt. So it doesn't go to the PA because we don't allow any money to go to the PA. And the third type of money is we give money to NGOs, to non-governmental organizations that are doing health and schools and other forms of development that are going on that are supervised by the United States government that are in contracts with those NGOs. So actually the amount of money that goes from the United States government to the Palestinian Authority that they can then use as cash is zero. That's the fact.
So let me ask you a question. If the policies that you advocate and that J Street advocates seem to me to be the policies that have been pursued by left-wing governments of Israel in times past. If they didn't work repeatedly, because most of Israel's history were left-wing governments, not right-wing governments, what makes you assume that in an increasingly radicalized Islamic culture with the influence of Iran and the collapse of Syria and Hamas in Gaza, they're suddenly going to work now?
Well, I'm not assuming anything. In fact, I would probably say there is not even a 50-50 chance it would work. The question is it in Israel's interest to keep going down the path we're going down? Is it in Israel's interest to maintain a military occupation of millions of people without rights? Is it in Israel's interest to have a 25% growth in the number of settlers every decade that are living beyond the green line? Is it in Israel's security interest?
These questions are rhetorical, people.
Right. So, you know, look, some people may think it is in Israel's interest.
Right.
There are those of us who believe it is not. And in fact, a very large percentage of Israelis do not believe it is in their self-interest to be doing this. So the discussion that we're having is the discussion over whether or not there's any
okay,
way.
Okay, let me ask you the same question that I understand, and I think everybody here understands, all the things that you believe that the Palestinians and the Arab world have done that's evil and wrong. What mistakes did Israel make? What could Israel have done better, and what could Israel do better now, or are they blameless in this entire...
Well, I asked Yitzhak Rabin why he was going to allow weapons to be given to the PA police as soon as Oslo began. I said, shouldn't you wait a year to make sure they're not going to be using them against Israel? And he said to me, what army were you the general of, Mr. Klein? That was a mistake. But the biggest mistake is a mistake that Amos Oz, a left-wing guy, and Dennis Ross both said the biggest mistake was right from the beginning, when the Palestinian Authority was not outlawing terrorist groups like Hamas and Palestinian terrorist groups, not arresting terrorists in any serious way, still promoting hatred and violence, naming schools and streets. Israel should have immediately said, we will not continue until you stop and make a public issue
out of it. Not continue what?
The continued negotiation, okay, and hope for a resolution. Look, I hope and pray. I wish the Palestinian Authority would start acting like Canada. I think Canada's still okay.
Yes.
would start acting like Canada or some other civilized country, and so we can have a resolution. If a Palestinian state would ensure 100 or more years of peace, I, as one Jew, I'm not speaking for my organization, we haven't discussed this, would not be against it. But I am against establishing an Islamic terrorist state that'll be run by Hamas and Iran. It'll make it much worse than it is now. It's bad to horrible. Just like Gaza was bad to now we have horrible.
Okay, but I just want to point out, I guess what I was asking when I asked you if Israel made any mistakes was, can you tell me, I wasn't asking so much, can you tell me ways in which Israel should have been tougher? Which was really what you told me. I was asking whether you thought Israel made any diplomatic mistakes, any overtures they might have made that they didn't. Is there any way in which they could have been more embracing, welcoming? If there isn't, there isn't. But I just want to know if you think there is.
Rabbi, when Barak and Olmert offered over 90% of Judea and Samaria and half of Jerusalem for a full state, and by the way, Olmert offered that the holy places, the Temple Mount and the Western Wall, would be run by a group of countries, including Saudi Arabia and Jordan. What more could they have done
than that? So essentially, there is no act of kindness or overtures that Israel could have made that they didn't.
They've done that, and they're begging for negotiations,
okay,
and I don't see it. I'd like to know, because I'd like Israel to do it if there's something else they can do except offer virtually everything and say, let's sit down and negotiate, especially in light of the fact that the last United Nations meeting, Mahmoud Abbas said, Palestinian admission to the United Nations as a state will simply pave the way for the internationalization of the conflict as a legal matter, not only a political one. It'll pave the way for us to pursue claims against Israel to UN, human rights treaty bodies, International Court of Justice. He didn't say it'll bring peace. He says it to us openly. Why aren't we listening to him, ladies and gentlemen?
Well, surely you can't think that the UN has any hostility towards Israel.
Look, the United Nations is a hotbed of anti-Israel activism, and that, you know,
a point
we
of agreement,
agree. We agree.
A point of agreement.
He's not inaccurate.
It's very unfortunate. I mean, there's going to be agreement on some things, which is good. That being said, the United Nations in 1947 laid out the terms of a potential two-state solution when the British handed back the mandate. And the Arabs rejected it. And here we are, 68 years later, still without borders of a state of Israel. The United Nations has laid down its ideas in 1968 and in 1974 in resolutions 242 and 338 about how to resolve the conflict, I, for one, and J Street, for one, believes it would be helpful for the United Nations Security Council unanimously, including Arab countries, including the United States, to lay out again the parameters of the resolution of this conflict.
Let me ask you, on that point, which do you think was more effective in reducing Palestinian terrorism and actions against Israel, overtures or the wall?
Oh, when you say the
fence,
word overtures,
the fence, it's not a wall.
Fence.
When you say the word overtures, what do you mean?
Anything that Israel has done in terms of peace offerings or...
Well, again, I will say what I have read and heard Israeli security forces say. Mort will say he's talked to a general who disagrees. So
General Ya'alon.
So this is...
He already knows which general disagrees with
this
you.
Is gonna be
even
top
before
general.
You say it, he knows which
the
one.
Top general.
But the security that is greater today than when I lived in Jerusalem and buses were blowing up and my cafes were blowing up and all the rest of it, it is greater today, and I believe that the fence wall barrier, that has a role to play. I believe that good fences make good neighbors. I think fences should be on borders, the border that people agree on, and it shouldn't be unilaterally decided to separate Palestinians from their schools and Palestinians from their businesses and arbitrarily go in the middle of their villages. So I am a believer in the wall, and I think it does contribute to security.
The fence.
But I also believe that the Palestinian security forces, as said by many Israeli generals, have been an extraordinary partner. And contrary to what Mort is saying, they have consistently cracked down on terror cells. They have not united with Hamas, although one of the arguments from the right wing is we can't make peace with the Palestinians because they're divided. But then, God forbid, they unite, then we say, well, we can't make peace with the Palestinians because they're now united. So, the opponents of doing this have it both ways. And in our view, one of the critical things to allowing the Palestinian people to be an effective, credible partner is there has to be Palestinian political unification, and it's going to have to be on the basis of the acceptance of the State of Israel, of nonviolence, and of Palestinian commitments to international agreements. That's our position. But we think it would be a good thing for there to be political reconciliation among the Palestinians, but there hasn't been, and again, that's a misstatement that Mort presented to you all earlier. They do, in fact, crack down on Hamas cells on the West Bank, and the IDF does consider that to be key to Israel's security.
Let me ask you about something else. I want to go on to something else, because obviously we're very close to an agreement here.
We don't like the UN Human Rights Council.
I want to get on to one more topic and then have closing statements. I know that you have very different diagnoses of what motivates and what and how the BDS movement should be dealt with. So since this is of tremendous interest, I hope, to this community and certainly to the local colleges, I wonder if both of you would give a minute or two or three on BDS and how the American Jewish community ought to respond, and then I'm going to ask you for closing statements. So, Mort, you want to...
No.
Jeremy, you want to start with
BDS?
Sure,
and J Street's opposed to BDS. Number one, the BDS movement doesn't recognize Israel's right to exist. Number two, the BDS movement doesn't support a two-state solution. And number three, the BDS movement doesn't make a distinction between an opposition to the existence of the State of Israel and an opposition to the occupation of the Palestinian territory. So for those reasons, we oppose the BDS movement. But what we say to the Jewish community is, you're not going to defeat the BDS movement with arguments like were presented here tonight by Mort. You're going to defeat the BDS movement when the Palestinian people have their dignity and their rights and their self-determination and the occupation ends. That's the only way that the BDS movement is actually going to be defeated. Because if the occupation continues, and if settlements continue to grow at the rate they're growing, and if Palestinian anger and frustration and depression grow, then we are going to see a continued growth of the BDS movement. We're going to see a continued isolation of Israel on the international stage. And we're going to see a growth of worldwide anti-Semitism as a result of this. And so the best way to defeat this movement is to achieve a two-state solution that gets the Palestinian and the Israeli people their rights.
Well, I have to say, Jeremy, you have a peculiar way of being opposed to BDS. First of all, your former head of your campus program, J Street U, I think it's called, has tweeted that she supports BDS. Working for you supports BDS. You've invited to your conferences a list of the greatest BDS supporters in the country. Mustafa Barghouti, one of the leaders, Will Comerson from JVP, Salam al-Mariati, who's said that Israel should be destroyed. You invited him to speak. Peter Beinart, Michael Fards, Lawfare BDS, Sue Beninga, Baskin, Sai Barakat, one after the other. So you've been bringing in BDS people regularly. I'm not aware of you bringing anyone to speak out against BDS your conferences. You never brought in anyone your conferences to speak out against the Iran deal. You claim you want a Big Ten. You fought us for BDS laws in states to stop laws against BDS in states. The best way to fight BDS is to expose the truth of the Arab-Islamic war against Israel. That's what it is. This is not about Palestinian statehood. This is about Israel's destruction. They don't say, get rid of the West Bank, throw the Jews out. 80% of the murders of Jews by the Arabs in the last 23 years are within the 67 line. When they controlled from 48 to 67, all of Judea and Samaria, all of Gaza, the Golan, Eastern Jerusalem, they did not set up a state. This is about Israel's destruction. That's why nothing works. And if you set up a state, it'll be a Hamas-Fatah state. And Fatah will soon become Hamas. This is very dangerous. So we are working at ZOA to have a national law against BDS. I believe we were trying to have part of this is the T, one of the trade laws, to have BDS part of it. And you, at J Street, fought against having this added to this trade law. So I don't believe you when you say you're against BDS, because you've
even
said
not telling the truth about
those who
once
support
again,
those who support the views of J Street, you said, will probably support BDS.
So, all right, I definitely just I learned that I need to keep my pen out to keep track of the inaccuracies. Okay, so number one, J Street actually was a co-sponsor of the California anti-BDS law. Did you hear me say that?
Sometimes you were, sometimes you weren't.
J Street was a co-sponsor of the law, the anti-BDS law in California.
In other states, you were not.
So, in the federal law, the issue for us was the blurring of the distinction between Israel and the territories. United States law, for 50 years, in every single law the United States has passed, has limited the application of that law to the state of Israel as defined by the 1967 lines. This law, the trade law, and this BDS component, for the very first time in American history, was going to equate the territories that Israel controls with the state of Israel. That's what we objected to. Our amendment was to say, if you strike and the territories it controls, we will support the bill. We were willing to support the anti-BDS provision of the bill. We weren't willing to support the blurring of the distinction in American law. The state of Israel is not the territory that it occupied in 1967 on the West Bank. Under American law, under international law, nobody in the world recognizes that as part of the state of Israel, and the United States hasn't done it for 49 years. And that's what we said. Folks like Mort and others on the right of this community are blurring that distinction. You're forgetting that there is a legal distinction. And if there is to be a state for the Palestinian people, it will be on the territory that Israel conquered in 1967 in a defensive war from Jordan, which was occupying the territory. I'm willing to be very straightforward with the facts. This is exactly what happened, but Jordan was occupying it and Israel's occupying it. It is not part of the state of Israel. So that is what we fought. Yes, we invite people to our conference who support BDS. We invite them to panels about BDS and we present them with the arguments against BDS. We do it because we think the best way to persuade our people, who, by the way, are the most likely to be persuaded to potentially support the BDS movement, the best way to defeat the BDS arguments is to engage. So you charge us with engaging? Guilty. We engage with the people who support BDS because we think that's the best way to argue against them and to win the argument. So yes, we invited those people, and okay. I think that's the appropriate way to deal with it.
All right, now to both of you, you have this is your closing statement, and then the election is Tuesday. So I believe you spoke
and
first.
We're not running.
Is that correct? So Mort, you get to close first. Each of you has minutes.
How much?
Until it seems like the other guy should go. I don't
okay,
know.
I'll
take 3-4 minutes.
It is very perplexing to me. If you are, in fact, a pro-Israel organization, as opposed to, for example, only this week you're lobbying against a group of senators who want to increase the amount of money to Israel after the MOU, the Memorandum of Understanding, they want to increase it by $1.5 billion, and you're lobbying against that increase, saying we have too many needs at home. I never saw you lobby against aid to the Palestinian Authority based on their actions. And it's peculiar to me, in the articles in the Jerusalem Post, they state that 10% of your money come from people who are either anti-Israel or people who are involved with anti-Israel groups like Nancy Dutton and Judith Barnett and Genevieve Lynch, NIAC, and mostly George Soros, which for 3 years, I believe, you publicly lied and said you get no money from George Soros, who is an ardent anti-Zionist, he says so proudly, against Israel's existence, who says that the greatest year of his life was 1944. He helped Nazis find out where the Jews were living. Why would George Soros and these anti-Israel people who represent Arab groups be donors to you if you're so pro-Israel? It's really rather peculiar. And I guess basically what I would say is, please listen to what Mahmoud Abbas says. You know, to take an extreme example, the Germans in the 30s were telling everyone they just wanted peace. Just give us Sudetenland, we want peace. They were lying to everyone. Here we have a situation where the Palestinian Authority and the Arabs are telling us the truth. We want to destroy Israel. We don't accept Israel as a state. We won't even negotiate. The Israelis are filth. Mahmoud Abbas has publicly said the Israeli Jews want to destroy the Al-Aqsa Mosque. Go and spill blood to stop that. In other words, terrorize Israel, even if it means that you die. He's telling us openly he has no interest in Israel's existence, and that's and yet you call him a moderate peace seeker. And you know that area is called Palestine. Isn't it peculiar? They claim this is their Arab land. Why does it have a Roman name? This is Philistinia. This is named by the Romans. Many cities there were renamed from Hebrew names to Roman names, to Arab names. This is called Palestine. It's not even an Arab name. Palestinians used to mean Jews, by the way. And for all these reasons and many others, that's why Alan Dershowitz, who himself is a liberal Democrat, who himself has views different from mine on the issue, even though we are honoring him at our dinner on November 20th,
and you're all invited.
And you're all invited, and it's quite cheap. J Street is never invited. I don't believe Alan Dershowitz to speak. They've never invited me to speak.
I wonder
me
why.
On the panel. And Alan you invite BDS people, invite me to speak to convince me why I'm wrong. Put me on the panel, convince me why I'm wrong.
Okay, wrap it up.
And that's why Alan Dershowitz has said repeatedly in film and in writings that J Street is the most dangerous anti-Israel group in America.
I didn't come here
that's
for
Alan
that,
Dershowitz.
Okay.
You know, I'll say as my closing remarks, I did not come here tonight to sit here and endure the lies and the accusations.
Did Dershowitz say that?
No, wait.
You know, the terms of this discussion, I hope that most of you here tonight came to talk about the U.S.-Israel relationship, to talk about the issues, to talk about the future, to try to figure out
a way forward. I'm not claiming that there's any easy answers. And I'm not going to claim that the people with whom Israel has been fighting are not its enemies. My great-grandparents were in the first Aliyah in 1882. They helped establish Petah Tikva. My grandparents were one of the 60 families who founded Tel Aviv. My father was one of the first boys born there. And as the rabbi said, or maybe Mort said, my father fought in the Irgun in 1948.
That
and was
me.
Unbelievably close to Menachem Begin, Netanyahu's father. I've lived in Israel. I have 500 cousins in Israel. I have started a business in Israel. I've nearly been killed in terrorist attack in Machane Yehuda. I take this very, very, very seriously. And I recognize that what I'm expressing are opinions about what is good for the Jewish people, what's good for American interests and American foreign policy, and I'm willing to discuss that. And that's why I came here tonight, to lay out to you what J Street's views are about how best to try to save the incredible enterprise of building a national homeland of the Jewish people in the land that our ancestors lived in for 2,000 years ago. It's an amazing miracle, it's an amazing story, and it is my belief, it's the belief of many Israelis, it's the belief of many former prime ministers of Israel, former defense ministers, former heads of the Shin Bet, that that entire enterprise is at risk because of the policies that are being followed by the present government of Israel. We need a different approach, in my opinion and in J Street's opinion, both to the U.S.-Israel relationship and to Israel's policy in order to ensure that there's a Jewish and a democratic and a secure Israel that's a national home of our people and that lives up to the values and the principles of our people. That's what I came here tonight to discuss. If you want to read the answers to all of Mort's accusations, they're all on our website, and they've all been covered many times in the press, and I don't think it's particularly illuminating, but I think that we as a Jewish community, and I think in synagogues all across this country, we should be having an honest conversation about the road forward for the enterprise of a national home of the Jewish people. Whatever your views are on the politics of the issue, I hope you'll stay engaged in that conversation. I hope you'll have civil discussions and debates with those with whom you disagree. And I hope that we'll provide an opportunity for our next generation to see us address this issue openly and honestly, because one of the greatest tragedies, I think, Rabbi, is that we are turning off the younger generation from a connection to the state of Israel through the state of the discourse around this issue.
Okay. Before we close, I want to thank our program director, Rebecca Small, and the chairman of our Adult Education Committee, Jamie Berman, for arranging this evening. You know, I have a friend who says, Jews don't listen, they wait. And it certainly is true that we're all waiting to express our own opinions, and I know that it was frustrating for many of you not to be able to have your questions read or to express your opinion, and I really want to express my gratitude to all of you for an extremely civil audience that we had this evening, even though these are difficult and contentious issues. But also, I want to remind you that this week we read Parshat Noach. And Parshat Noach, God promises that he'll never destroy the world again. But there's a chilling omission in that story. God doesn't promise that we won't. And the truth is that what we're discussing tonight is nothing less than the survival of the state of Israel in one way or another. So I don't want, by asking you to be civil, for a moment to imagine that these aren't life and death issues. They really are, and we have to take them seriously, and we have to debate them honestly, and I hope that this will stimulate further discussion and argument and debate, and good luck to us all. Thank you.